Wow, what a wonderful, informative, and inspiring talk by both our panelists, Dr. Bhandari and Dr. Raga. And after hearing such an invigorating talk, I'm sure there's one part of our body that's in overdrive, trying to process all the information, trying to make sense of it, trying to have this emotional journey inside of us, how to stop our cravings, and how to self-heal, as rightly pointed by Dr. Bhandari. So, with no guesses, no prizes for guessing here what organ I'm talking about. It's the brain. And we all know, and we've all heard, the brain is the CPU of our bodies. And without the CPU, the computer doesn't work. And therefore, without giving due importance to our brains, we would not work. And as the saying goes, a sound mind resides in a sound body. And therefore, we have to take care of our bodies and the minds in order to lead a meaningful and productive life. So the topic for my talk today is brain health, the foods and the feeds. So let's get started. Right. Brain health, food, and feeds. So what I'll be talking about is how to take care of our brains, which is often the most neglected parts of our body. And to some extent, it's stigmatized. Whenever we talk of mental well-being or brain health, it's always a hush-hush topic. No one comes out in the open and discusses these issues. So I thought today is the pertinent time and the right kind of audience, so I chose this topic. Why do we think the brain is so important? Why do we give it so much importance? Now, just a quick glance on the picture that I've put on the left of the slide would give you a slight idea of what all our brain does for us, right from controlling the most vital functions of our body to stay alive and lead a meaningful, productive life, to allowing us to express our feelings, to be happy, to have mood swings, to feel, and to think. Now, for humans, being able to think makes us superior. And that is what sets us apart from the other living beings. Without the brain, we would not have the power of processing or analyzing. And that kind of would make us redundant, don't you think? And that would make it impossible for us to ride and rise up the ladder of evolution. It also touches on a very soft chord. It stores memories. And memories is something we always cherish. We learn from unpleasant memories, and we have this happiness around us when we think of all the good memories. Besides this, the brain also controls and coordinates our body's actions and reactions. So it's extremely important that our brain works perfectly well, and therefore, we have to take care of our brain. Again, coming back to the point, despite the brain doing so much for us, why do we neglect it? Why don't we go and ask the doctor when we go for our annual medical checkup? Is our brain functioning well? Why don't we discuss our small issues as overreacting over something or feeling a little depressed over something and not take corrective action? So today, let's give brain the place it deserves in our bodies and our lives. And I, if you all allow me to say that, have come here as an advocate for our brain to do something about the brain. Okay, so whenever we talk of the brain, there's always this benchmark that Albert Einstein, he was a genius and he had a fabulous brain. He had the brain which everyone looks up to, because there's also a saying, oh, no, you don't have an Einstein's brain. So let's talk about how Einstein's brain was a little different. Now, let me tell you a story. which I recently discovered, and I'm sure most of you would discover today. After Albert Einstein passed away, his brain was stolen by none other than the pathologist Thomas Harvey, because he was so intrigued by the enigma of Einstein's brain that he wanted to study it. And believe me or not, after removal, Einstein's brain was stored in jars in his basement for over 40 years. And only after that time did the people come to know that the brain has been stolen. So how was Einstein's brain different than the normal brain of a typical human being? Studies showed that in Einstein's brain, the regions involved in speech and language were smaller, whilst the regions involved with numerical and spatial processing were larger, and therefore it made him the genius he was. But don't despair, there's always hope for all of us because of the field called neuroplasticity. Now, neuroplasticity is a relatively newer concept and a relatively newer field, which gives us the assurance and the hope that the brain is continuously changing. We can alter the efficiency of our brain, we can alter the health of our brain, and lead a more productive, intellectually stimulating, and a happy life. But just about how do we do that? Well, taking care of the brain is composed of taking care of these six aspects. Now, as we put it, these are the six pillars of a healthy brain: food and nutrition, physical fitness, social interaction, mental health, sleep. Yes, you heard me right, sleep. So go on, sleep well, and relaxation. And of course, medical health. So in my talk, I would be addressing each of these pillars separately and guiding you as to how we can healthify our brains. Let's talk about food and nutrition first. Well, we all know the brain occupies a very small portion of our body. It's about 2% of our body weight, but it consumes approximately 20% of glucose-derived energy. And don't get all hyper. By glucose, I don't mean simple sugars or a high sugar diet or a soda on the way. We have to derive this glucose from complex carbohydrates. And as Dr. Aga rightfully suggested, that it's better to have complex carbohydrates than simple carbohydrates, which are best avoided, and therefore supply the brain with the much needed energy. Because our brain is a very energy dense organ, it requires a lot of energy. The second nutrient is proteins. We should have adequate proteins in our diet, because the major component of our neurotransmitters like dopamine, serotonin are amino acids. And we all know serotonin is the happy neurotransmitter. And who would not like to be happy? So it's important and imperative that we include good quality proteins in our diet. And it has been shown by studies, which I have cited in the reference in my slide, that 80% of us have subpar neurotransmitter levels. That means we can always do better. And enhanced protein intake has also been shown to enhance the neurotransmitter levels, and which naturally translates into a higher efficient working brain. Third, fats. And again, as already discussed, fats is like the necessary evil and has been really made into the devil to its discredit, which it definitely isn't. Fats are very important for us, because even in vitamins, we have these fat soluble vitamins which need fats to be properly assimilated in the body. And those fat soluble vitamins are A, D, E, K, Therefore, the catch here is, rather than gorging on a hamburger, or rather than gorging on a burger from a fast food chain, why not have an avocado instead? Why not have walnuts instead? Therefore, we should include good quality fats in our diet, predominantly omega-3 fats. Additionally, vitamins B, C, D, and E are essential in brain health and development, and therefore foods rich in these vitamins should be included in the diet, as well as foods rich in magnesium, because all this would translate into a healthy functioning brain. Now, the obvious question on all of your minds is, you've told us about the nutrients. What about what do we eat? So this is a list of all the beneficial foods for the brain. And to start with, green tea. So if you haven't had your cup of green tea, go ahead and have it, and that will help your brain. Plus, green leafy vegetables. Please do not smirk at the sight of green leafy vegetables on your plate, because they would do you enormous good. Second, fatty fish. But with fatty fish, you have to be careful that the fish should not be high in mercury, because mercury has a detrimental effect on the brain. Berries, which are extremely high in antioxidants and stop the inflammation in the brain, as well as scavenge the free radicals, which slows down aging and helps healthify the brain. Walnuts, which we all know, we've been told since we were kids. Do you know the shape of a walnut? It's like the shape of your brain. So have it to have a healthy brain. And they weren't wrong, because walnuts are composed of omega fats, which are extremely beneficial for the brain. Then comes turmeric, the golden spice and the golden latte, which is so popular these days. It's nothing but a regular haldi ka doodh that we've been told as children to have it. And turmeric has a compound called curcumin, which stops inflammation, is an excellent antibiotic and superfood for the brain. Then comes the cruciferous vegetables, which are broccoli, cauliflower, cabbage, Brussels sprouts, etc. Then, dark chocolate. So all of you who are fond of chocolate, please take a pause and read the word dark in front of the chocolate. So the usual milk chocolate is not good for the brain and not a good justification to go and eat the chocolate on your way. But dark chocolate has flavonoids which benefit the brain. Then eggs, which have choline, which is a precursor to our neurotransmitter acetylcholine, and therefore, again, beneficial. Pumpkin seeds for their good fats, vitamin C-rich foods to suppress inflammation, green tea for flavonoids, and coffee. All these foods are super for the brain. Next, as Dr. Bhandari talked about our always reluctance and the first step to get out of bed, I give you one more reason, supplementing the excellent reasons that he gave to go on the treadmill, is to put your brain on the treadmill and start exercising. Because studies have shown that exercising improves blood flow and memory and stimulates certain chemical changes in the body, which enhance learning, mood, and thinking. In a study done by the University of Columbia, it was found that regular aerobic exercise increases the size of your hippocampus, which is the brain area involved in verbal memory and learning. So it becomes very important for us to inculcate the habit of exercising right from childhood. And as they say, it's never too late. So you can pick up exercising at any stage in life. Now, this is a study that was done in 2018, and this emphasizes the impact of exercise on our brains. Now, this study took 81 participants, 53 of whom were already diagnosed with mild cognitive impairment, which is malfunctioning of the brain. So, all the participants were asked to take a maximal oxygen test. And after that, their brains were subjected to a diffusion tensor imaging to reveal the health of the white matter. Now, here are the results. Lower levels of aerobic fitness were linked with weaker white matter in certain parts of the MCI participants' brains. Second, the MCI participants with lower aerobic fitness and weaker white matter also performed worse on the memory and reasoning tests. Excuse me. The conclusion is, please pardon my cough, just because my throat is a little drying up. So, greater physical fitness correlates with healthier white matter plus better memory and reasoning abilities, even for those who already suffer from a level of cognitive impairment. So imagine if physical fitness or physical exercise can have such a beneficial effect on people already suffering from cognitive impairment, what it would do for normal, healthy functioning individuals. Therefore, get up, get moving, get on the treadmill, or engage in any kind of physical exercise, which could be dancing, which could be running around. So this is the reason to start exercising. Well, the third pillar is social interaction. Now, this is very interesting, being discovered in the times of the COVID-19 pandemic, because during these times, it has become a little difficult for us to have our usual social interactions. And it has also increased incidences of people going into their inner shells, becoming a little depressed, becoming upset, becoming frustrated, and all that impacts the brain. Therefore, to avoid these feelings, we should make the best use of what is available to us, be it virtually in touch, picking up the phone and speaking to somebody, having a video chat. But being socially active is extremely important, and it helps in brain health. Now, this is a statement by Susan Pinker, who's a very famous development psychologist. Now, she has given the scientific bent to what social interaction does for us. And as you can see, face-to-face contact, shaking hands, giving a high five to somebody, or just talking to somebody increases our neurotransmitter levels, and they are released into the bloodstream. It increases oxytocin and lowers cortisol levels. So social interaction is extremely beneficial for our well-being, for a mood elevation, and to lower our stress. And besides this, dopamine, which is also a very happy neurotransmitter, helps us in quelling the pain. And it's almost like the effect of morphine, which is a drug which is given for reducing pain. So see, just a small gesture of interacting with another being can have on our brain health and improve our brain health. So it's extremely crucial to not lead an isolated life, to interact with other beings and lead a meaningful, productive life. The next pillar of brain health is mental health. Now, a lot of people confuse the concept of brain health and mental health. Well, mental health, according to psychologist Martin Seligman, can be equated in the acronym PERMA. I'd like to call this permanent. And so let's all try to make mental health a permanent feature for all of us. What is PERMA? It is a composite of positive emotions, which is thinking positively. Don't think about what bad could happen. Think about what good things could happen to you. Think about how blessed you are. Second is engagement. Your mind should always be at work. Now, when we say an idle mind is a devil's workshop, it has some truth to it. So when you are engaged in some kind of constructive activity, like listening to music, learning a new art, it has a very positive effect on the brain. Third, relationships. Nurture relationships, build relationships, nourish relationships. Fourth, meaning and purpose. Now, this has been observed as a common phenomena that with aging comes a sense of meaninglessness in your lives. That should be really avoided. And also, it has been seen in children who are constantly abused or, you know, spoken rudely with. They kind of lose focus and lose a meaning and purpose to life. Well, that should be regained. One should always have something to look up to. Should think about positive things around and something to do. We all have something in us which can benefit others or even benefit ourselves. So why not tap on that little hidden talent we have and explore that to lead a mentally healthy life? And the A from PERMA is accomplishments. By accomplishments, I don't mean something extraordinary or you have to come out at the top of what you're doing and always be in constant competition with either yourself or others around you. Even small accomplishments, like as Dr. Bhandari said, getting out of bed every morning to exercise and take care of ourselves is an accomplishment. Modifying our lifestyle, modifying our diet is an accomplishment. So we should all do a composite of these five things to have a sound mental health. Now, what can we do to challenge our brain? Solve crossword puzzles. Do jigsaw puzzles with small kids in your house or young adults. Engage in brain teasers. Pick up a new skill, something that you've always wanted to learn but did not have the time and energy or the resources to do it. This is the time. Learn a new language for better social interaction. Listen to music and dance like no one's watching. You should be completely stress-free. You should engage in activities that provide relaxation to your brain. And these things help in the long run. Okay, so now comes the topic of sleep and relaxation. Before I start elaborating on the benefits of sleep, there's a small disclaimer. This does not give you a license to sleep throughout the day or sleep at odd hours or sleep longer than required, because even that has a detrimental effect on your health. Please sleep for normal, healthy hours, and the quality of sleep is more important than the quantity of sleep. So as they say, sleep like a baby. You should sleep like a baby without any thoughts in your mind and completely clear. There shouldn't be any clouds in your brain when you're sleeping. Now, coming to the point as to why is sleep important? Well, studies have shown that sleep flushes out the toxins from our brain and the body, which build up during our waking hours. And believe me, while we are awake, there are thousands of toxins that are continuously being built up. So while we are sleeping, these are flushed out. And primarily, there has been new research in the area of the lymphatic system, which has shown that the beta amyloid protein, which is a toxin, is flushed out during our sleep, and the accumulation of this compound has been shown to be in the Alzheimer's disease patients. Therefore, it's extremely crucial that this does not accumulate in our body. The third point, deep relaxation and meditation shuts down the release of stress chemicals, and it counteracts the effect of some of these chemicals. Therefore, it's beneficial. Now, this is a pictorial representation of some scientific ways to de-stress given by Anna Vital. And these are, as you can see, listening to binaural beats, progressive relaxation, which is the simple squeeze and release and repeat exercise, the nature observation. And I'm sure we all have observed that concrete buildings don't give us the same amount of relaxation that going out in the open, going outdoors, going out amidst nature give us. Deep breathing, practice deep breathing, mental image. Now, this is the power of positivity. Imagine you're in a place where you want to be, and imagine what you want to happen. And that will bring a smile on your face and will help you to relax. Then is body scan, which is also called Dhyan Nidra. Punch, well, I would not advise that given these circumstances, because we have paucity of space and paucity of things to punch on. So please refrain. Don't do this at home too often. And journaling. Journaling has been found to have a profound effect on our relaxation, because there are a number of things we cannot talk about. So why not just pen them out in the journal? And that's between you and the journal. And journals don't speak. So be rest assured, if you keep it safely, no one's going to know about it. And let out your feelings. Don't hold anything inside. And that will help greatly. The last but not the least, and also extremely important, is medical health. Studies have shown that people who are obese, who have a heart condition, who have diabetes, who have hypertension, are more susceptible to cognitive impairment or degeneration of the brain, or neurodegeneration as we call it. So instances of dementia, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, etc. has been found to be more in patients of some kind of a disease. Therefore, it is extremely crucial to have an annual medical checkup to determine your health status and take corrective measures. How you could do that, how you can take care of medical health, is keep your blood pressure and weight at a healthy level, take medications as prescribed, cut down on salt and sugar, keep active, and stay socially connected and positive. Well, I'm sure your brain is now in a complete overdrive and is really trying to process all this information. So I'll help you in a certain way and give you the key takeaways from this talk. The first is, pay attention to your brain. Do not neglect the brain. Eat a healthy, balanced diet, exercise regularly, keep your connections alive, and stay connected in the real world, not just virtual. Sleep well and adequately, quality sleep. Learn to relax often. The world will go on. Relax. Everything will be there. Don't worry. Go for an annual medical checkup and find ways to channelize the brain and keep it active. I would like to leave you all with a parting thought. Stop being afraid of what could go wrong and start being excited about what could go right. And that way, our brains would be healthy, we would be healthy, and we would lead a meaningful, productive life. So with this, I end my talk.